What?
Yo, Pat, I see you, queen.
Thank you.
I see you.
I appreciate you.
It's all
Thank you.
love.
Your skin is glistening, though. Come on.
Is it, you know what? I had just taken a shower. This is like my first shower in like a week.
No, I love the dewy look. You
You
got
like
it.
it?
I do, especially when I makeup, because you don't want nothing like caked up. I mean, not
Yeah.
makeup. That's a natural glow that you have going on.
Hey, I appreciate that. How are you?
I'm good. You know, enjoying quarantine to the best of my ability.
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm doing really good. I'm really good. Cooking, learning new recipes. I stopped sleeping. I think at the very beginning of quarantine, like all I did was sleep, but now I'm chilling, so I'm good.
Yeah, you got it's like you needed to like get that catch up of energy just because it's like why not? We're at home, you know, do what you need to do. But first and foremost, congratulations.
Thank
Four
you.
nominations, daytime Emmy nominations. That's crazy.
Yeah.
It's I feel like literally for the people out there, I already told y'all, but watch it. All the episodes are on YouTube right now. Y'all can watch it. It's so good. Like you
Thank
said,
you.
some of your other interviews, stories of black stories in particular that are not often told. So amazing. So again, congratulations. Love it. Cannot wait for season two.
We gotta see. We gotta have some money for season two. Season one was hella expensive, and it came out of my pocket. So we gotta see what goes on for season two. But thank you very much. I appreciate all the love. Black people really been showing a lot of love, especially for these Emmy nominations. So that feels incredible. I appreciate it.
Yeah, no, I just want to, you know, I obviously like to jump to your backstory first. Let's talk about this, you working in the organ donation industry before. It's, listen, I think that's super dope because one, you said in your interviews that you were passionate about it. Like, it's not something that you were like just doing just to make money. You actually loved doing it. And then when you had moved and you were kind of moving up into your career, 21 days later, you end up losing your job. And then that's when you transitioned into independent filmmaking. So, kind of give me a little bit of that. Really, I guess I want to know what was it about independent filmmaking, like not any other industry, that was what you wanted to do.
So it was interesting because I never really saw myself as an independent content creator. Like I was just really doing my thing. And I was working a career job. I was dating someone at the time, and I thought that, you know, marriage was next, and you know, I was scared as hell about that. But I got this job, and I thought like, yo, this is what I'm supposed to have and what I'm supposed to do. I got it another promotion, got to New Orleans, and in 21 days they fired me. As a matter of fact, in this culture that we're in right now, I wrote their asses a letter 2 weeks ago and let them know exactly what went down and how racism played a part in that because I didn't have no voice. Like, I couldn't come up and say, yo, like, this is what happened to me. And so I gave them my voice, and they were like, oh, wow. And, you know, we didn't know everything. Hey, we're going to change our culture. You know, all that shit happened. But what it did was, it was God's plan to put me on a path of where I'm supposed to be. And I never really wanted to do it independently either, let's be honest. I wanted to work and make this a career like I had already had. But the industry is so tough, it's so daunting. What you have to do is do it for yourself over and over and over and over again until you actually can have an actual seat at the table.
Yes, no, absolutely. It's so funny. I think it was Film Courage that your interview that you where you talked about the journey is what is the success part of it. The project that you're working on is the success part of it, not the, you know, the Emmy, even though you got your Emmy, but not, you know, right? It's more the project is what is should be giving you the energy and the momentum to keep going, not necessarily the goal that you've set for yourself. And I just thought that kind of set with me, and I was like, you know what? Because I know as a creative, it's hard. You're wanting that reassurance that you are good at what you do, and it often doesn't come until years later.
Yeah, no, 100%. Nah, I apologize for cutting you off. But the thing about it is, nothing is as satisfying as you really think that it's going to be. So, all I wanted coming into this, when we realized we were on the short list, I was like, oh, I want this series to be nominated. I want this series to be nominated. I wanted that so bad. And the series didn't get nominated, but I got nominated. And you would think that that would feel like so satisfying and so gratifying. But you know, as soon as that happens, then I start thinking, well, what can I do with this nomination? Like, if agents are going to start reaching out, is this going to happen? Is that going to happen? So it's like we always want what's next. Even if I win, it's going to be, well, what did other winners get? You know? So I had to really do the work on myself to enjoy what it is for what it was. It took me a couple of days to get there, Now I have no expectations and I'm just enjoying it. But it's interesting because I thought about what made me the happiest in this entire process. And Raquel, let me tell you what it was. It was when I was just doing the work, when I was just producing. That's not to say I didn't deal with no challenges and no nonsense, because I did. But at the end of the day, just being able to do the work mattered so much. And so that's why I said, well, let me focus on my next project. Let me do what's next to really get back into that groove of just doing the work. Because all this other stuff, I mean, fame is fleeting. So is support. I mean, it's just, it comes and it goes.
Absolutely. When you made that move to New York, $60, two bags, just full of clothes, what was in your mind? I guess you answered this actually in that interview, and y'all, please go watch it, because you be giving out gems. And like,
yo,
like real tea though. And one thing I want to give you a shout out for is that you have been a person who has been a teacher and an educator throughout your journey. Usually it takes, you know, they have those master classes now where it's like, oh, okay, you know, you have the Lena Waithe and you have the Oprahs that are giving you all of these gems, but you're doing it as your journey moves along. Whereas oftentimes, like I know for me personally, people have approached me like, oh, you know, can you tell me this? And I'm like, I don't feel like I'm there yet. But you have, you've just been like, look, I'm gonna tell you what I've done. I'm gonna tell you what has failed for me. And what is it like, I guess, kind of doing that? Do you ever feel like you don't know enough to tell someone something? Or do you feel like, look, I'm just gonna take the information that I have right now and give it to you the way that it is?
So listen, when I first got into the industry, I couldn't get a mentor to save my life. I was living in New Orleans, Louisiana. So of course, you know, Spike Lee's not living there. Tyler Perry's not living there. Nobody's living there. And I kept reaching out, trying to get like information and access. And it was nothing. And at the time, even the internet wasn't, it didn't have the plethora of information that it does now. I had to look at books. I had to look at movies. I used to watch the director's commentary just to get any perspective on how to do it. And so what I said was, there's no reason for me to hold on to what I know. Even if I know one or two things, that's enough to share with someone else. Because I think what happens with this industry, especially when you get to a certain level, people start trying to like hoard opportunities and hoard resources, not recognizing it's really enough for all of us to eat. And if you just let somebody else eat, they'll help you eat. And so I never had that mindset. I've never been a selfish dude. So I always put information out there as much as possible for others so that, not that it'll necessarily return back to me, so that I can continue to learn and I can continue to share and I can continue. And I tell everything. I tell numbers, what I get paid. I tell everything, because what's this nonsense industry that we come up in that it tells you can't say your budget? Why not? If you have an attainable budget, it tells another filmmaker that they could do it too. If you have... If BET pays me $40,000 and offer you $15,000, then you know, and with the same level of actors, you know you're getting played. So it's like that sharing of information is what we need to do. And that's not what we often do. And it's not mine. It was given to me, so it should pour out of me, because I don't own this information.
Come on. Okay. And then with the drink, you got a period, okay? First of all, because I know you're a wino. So what's your favorite wine really quick? And then we'll get on. I really want to talk about King Esther, because I mean, so many different things. But
yes, I didn't turn into a champagne dude. I got champagne taste.
Okay, because I was going to say he's going to be upset with me because I'm not a wine person. I love champagne. And really low key, I'm more of an herbalist, really. But if
that's
you
love.
Okay, I was going to say, if you know what that means, well, we just, you know, we're going to keep it real G on here. But yes, I'm more of an herbalist, but I love champagne. That's like my thing.
That's my thing too. I love it. All day, every day. Champagne. Toast.
Red
Cheers.
Right.
With Red cups and rosé.
No, I am like super fan. Like you really, I appreciate as a creative seeing someone take all those stepping stones and still give back. That is amazing. But King Esther, such an amazing, lovely, just energetic, very energetic story. Tell me what inspired you to write this. What made you want to tell this story? And why do you think that it hasn't been told? I mean, we're starting to see more of these stories. Like you have Pose, you have Legendary, which I love. The culture of the trans community is starting to come to a forefront from being behind the scenes for so long. But what was it about King Esther's story that made you want to tell it? And also too, I know that you have some of your own personal stories or experiences that you kind of put in there. So what was it about King Esther that was like, I need to tell the story?
So it was interesting. I had written a play called Inevitable Sadness of All Things Good, because I was at a point where I was a part of a religion. I still am, but I was in it and I was really questioning it. And it felt like only the holy and pious people could be received in this really like high esteem. And I fucked up a lot. I made a lot of mistakes. So I never saw myself in that sense. So I said, what if a hood dude got a message from God and he needed to preach to the people? Like, what would that story be? And within it, he had a sister named Esther from New Orleans. And so I decided to take that and just to exercise the skill of writing another character from an experience that I don't necessarily have ownership of. And so that's what I was able to do to bring King Esther to life. And I was really surprised. I had no idea that's what it would be. And honestly, I didn't even think that I could have permission to do it, because I know how woke culture works and how you have to not only do the project, but you have to face the project. So if Black Panther is, it has to be done by a Black person or everybody gonna be tight, or the Aretha story has to be done by a Black female, which is not necessarily how it was. Some of the most wonderful films from Black, Eddie Murphy's, be honest, pretty much all his films were white people, you know? Right. No, literally, Big Mama's House, I mean, Tearing Down the House, all those Queen Latifah, those are all from white filmmakers. White filmmakers don't have to look like the subjects that they're shooting. Black filmmakers, we have to look like the subject that we're shooting. And then when you go down the list of marginalization, when you really get into the struggle Olympics, then you really have to front and face and look just like that person. So I didn't think that I had the permission, but the community gave me permission. They said, listen, if you got the resources, Dame Figueroa Edie, shout out to her. She was like, if you got the resources to do it, do this story. And so I did it with everything I had in me, with as much heart as I could have and as much passion as I could put forward. And I did the story, and it just so happened to have caught on. But when we went into it, I didn't think it would get with Issa Rae. I didn't think there would be an Emmy nomination. I was just doing the work and making sure that I served this community as the best that I possibly could. That's all it was.
Absolutely. And I read that you had sent it, or you had said during Red Cups and Rosé that you had sent it to 25 different trans community organizations just to see, to get perspective. And I think that that's again, so many different steps that, like you said, aren't taken when it comes to Black stories, period. Oftentimes we're not even asked how we feel about it. It's just something that's just based. So I do want to give, you know, credit to that. Also, How did Issa Rae's Color Creative acquire, how did that collaboration happen?
Yeah, so that's interesting. And honestly, we didn't just reach out initially for perspective. We also had trans people working in front of, behind the camera. Angelica Ross is an executive producer. She has ownership of the series. Our story consultant, also a producer, is Dame Figueroa Edie. So they were a full part of the process. And that's the thing about Black creators. We just want to be a part of the process. Yes, it's wonderful that you got a Black crew on Black Panther. That's wonderful. But what about the rest of the Marvel movies? Why is it not a Black crew? Because the people at the head don't have that stream of consciousness. And I did. And thankfully, the community received me in kind. And so that was that. I don't even remember what the other part of that question, because I'm kind of turned up.
So how did the collaboration between Issa Rae's Color Creative and King Esther come?
Yeah, so Color Creative, of course, is leading the effort. Giants was nominated for 2 years previously. They're leading the effort in nuanced content. And so they had come to us kind of early on. They had heard about King Esther and they thought the work was dope. And so we reached out, they reached out, but it wasn't the right timing. It wasn't until like almost 8 months later that it just made sense for both parties. And of course, we were in the process of going and looking at different other people. So we had other choices. We had more profitable choices, but we decided to go with the platform that would give us the most views, and we wanted to support everybody Black.
Come on. Period, point blank.
And you point blank.
Okay. And you mentioned Angelica Ross, oh my goodness, and legend Janet Hubert. How did that happen? You guys go through the casting process, but when it came down, even to your lead actress, how did that all come together?
That's crazy how things happen just the way that they're supposed to. So I was in my building in Brooklyn talking to my neighbor, who's a hairstylist, and he was like, man, we see you coming building all the time. What you working on now? And I was like, well, I got this, you know, story that I'm working on about this family in New Orleans. And he was just asking. He was like, if you could have any actress in the world to be in that lead, well, who would that be? I said, well, I love Janet Huber. I said, people don't talk about her, but I love Janet Huber. That man almost fell out. He was like, guess what? I do Janet Huber's hair, and I'm going to connect y'all. That is exactly how it happened. And I sent her the stuff. She responded at like 2 in the morning. She said, this is amazing. The young filmmakers are the future. The old ones are washed up. Those are Janet Huber's words, not mine. That's what she said. And she was like, I got you. And she was like such a pleasure. She was so easy to work with. And you see the work that went into the excellence that she brought to Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. And I feel really bad what has kind of happened as far as being blackballed and being allowed to blackball somebody in this community. Because we as black people who work in white environments know what that's like and how unjust it is. But she's an icon. And she did her thing on our set and she brought our excellence. Now, getting her to do extra stuff is a challenge. But she got our back 100% all day. And Rowan was interesting, too. I just was telling him, I was sending it to my attorney. I said, hey, I got this, I'm looking for a black trans actress. I want someone who's recognizably trans, but still beautiful. And I would love a really dark, because, you know, every New Orleans store got these Creole, you know, everybody light skin, red bone, you know. But there's also a lot of dark-skinned New Orleanians as well. And so I wanted that to be represented. I wanted this to be a rich, dark-skinned family. And it was the perfect person. And I thought she lived in New Orleans. And come to find out, she lived one mile down the road.
And so Brooklyn. Wait, where are you originally from?
I'm from Arkansas.
Okay. I'm dead. Wait, not the... Listen, I'm from Missouri. So I...
Oh,
We
right there then. Exactly. We right there.
Oh, Ozarks, we there.
Yo, people, when I tell them I'm from Arkansas, they're like, oh, that's right by Idaho? Nah. A little farther.
Yeah, and just, you know, maybe not talk unless you're kind of sure. Yeah, no, the Midwest and the South kind of get mixed up together because people always say Missouri's the South, and I'm like, no, it's definitely the Midwest, but all right.
Sorry, this is getting on my nerves, this thing in the background. No, My sister thought this was like such a great idea, but it was hella distracting for me.
It's funny because Midway, I was thinking like, oh, I see why he did that because then it's cancer in the back. Like
I was trying to be hella witty, but you got to drop the contrast. You got to make it a little lower. It was competing against my skin, and I can't have that.
Listen, perfectionist, that's what you are.
That's what I am.
You okay? And now I want to know what's your sign.
I'm a Pisces.
Okay.
What are you?
I'm an Aries.
Oh, yeah. I'm very emotional. I was crying this morning.
I was going to say, a Pisces mystical, really mysterious people. Mm-hmm. So I'm into it. Yeah. One of the episodes that really stood out to me was Girl Talk. As a cisgender black woman, straight black woman, it is, I think that there seems to be a conversation, to be plain and simple, it's kind of a tug of war between the trans black woman community versus cisgender black women. And it's so funny because I was just talking to my friend yesterday or 2 days ago, and I was like, just talking about so many different things and elements that even for me, I'm still trying to understand and trying to learn. And I thought that scene between Esther and her sister was, perfect. Like, it really nailed how much cisgender black women love and appreciate trans black women, but at the same time, we're still missing the mark just a little bit. You know what I mean? And I think that I just wanted to applaud you about Girl Talk because it was perfect. You did it. You did that so well. And I love how at the end of the day, her sister was here for her, regardless of whatever it was. She may still stumble with the issues and understanding certain concepts, but she was there. And I think that created such a very important conversation, like you said, within the oppression that we put on ourselves within our own members of our own communities. Mm-hmm. So I, like I said, just want to applaud you. You said that King Mother Effin' Esther was the episode that was really emotional for you. Why is that? And that was also one of the, I think it was one of the longer ones that you had. Because you had, one thing too is, your writing just speaks to that because one, how can you tell a story within just 8 minutes? Like you're telling so much information in such a short time frame. And that's just, that in itself blows my mind.
Thank you. I mean, it's crazy because you think, you remember the Karate Kid? Mm-hmm. And remember he thought he was like paying defense, but really mm-hmm. he was learning how to defend, you know, he was doing, whack, you know, sign the floor, you know, all that kind of stuff. So that was going on with me. So when I was coming up, all I was doing was just trying to get better at making films. Like my homeboy Tyler, like we would be in New Orleans and I'm like, I got this script and it's all we got is like 6 pages. Let's try to shoot it. And so we would just shoot it. And some of it was good. Some of it wasn't. Some of it was casting. My sister's a terrible actress and trying to cast her, of course. I mean, come on. But, you know, we would do all sort of different things like that all the time. And so you didn't know and you don't realize that it starts to train your mind to be able to tell an active story in 7, 8, 10 minutes. We had no idea. So that's why I always tell filmmakers, just do your thing where you are. Just do your thing. Because if you just do your thing where you are, it's going to pay off later on down the line. And for me, I was hella tight earlier this year because I'm seeing creatives, you know, that ain't really done as much as me, like getting into writer's rooms, directing, you know, and I'm like, why am I not getting these opportunities? Because I'm not supposed to. Maybe I'm just supposed to lead an effort. And I recently just signed a deal with Universal to produce my first pilot. So it's like, you got to just keep your head down and your heart focused on what you're supposed to be doing. Because all that other stuff is just like purely nonsense. But that's how we was able to do such a good job. But the thing that I love the most about episode 4, what I felt like it was a conversation between two communities that need to be had. The hood niggas need to talk to their trans sisters, period, point blank. And they need to apologize in a way that is sincere, that is honest. It is not complete, because no apology is ever truly complete. It is the action afterwards that really make the apology actually matter. And I just wanted to actually see and have that done. So every time King and his sister get together in, one, you see how strong and Esther is, because she ain't scared of none of these niggas.
Right.
But then you also see her get what she so desperately needed and wanted, was that apology. And so that's why it's my favorite episode, because I wanted to try to do what I can as a cisgender man to help build that bridge.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Listen,
I've been drinking. Yeah. Yeah.
No, I'm just kidding with you. You did say that your friends came together, which I think is super dope. And celebrating your Emmy noms, as well as you're going to be opening a production company. And is it called Fort Greene?
The production company?
Yeah, because I don't know if I was like reading in between the lines. I was trying to.
Nah, it's cool. The name, I haven't told anybody yet. So this is an exclusive, a Raquel exclusive.
Listen.
No, Raquel Harris, right? Raquel Harris TV. All right, follow her. It's called Henry Asher Productions. And Henry is a very close man that helped raise me as a kid. And he told me this old Hebrew parable, which was Eya Asher Eya, which means I will to be whatever I will to be. And so I wanted to honor him by calling it Henry Asher Productions, because the best productions come not from a cloud like what I had done before, but from a man, right? And so I wanted to honor that man by naming my production company Henry Asher.
I love that.
Yeah, and we were lit. We were lit over in Fort Greene Park, and the cops didn't say anything.
Okay, wait. Okay, so this is in... this. I'm like, Fort Greene... because, you know, what's I think it's Beyonce that has that Parkwood as her fashion. I'm like, hey, it's so many... It's Parks, it's Fort Greene. I'm just trying to read it. Before I do want to let you go, because I know you like booked and busy. Super note, I love that you say that you add Adam and Eve allegories to your projects. I think that's why, like, why? Why does Adam and Eve stick with you in storytelling?
Well, one, I'm a PK. Mm-hmm. And so growing up, I was in Bible class 6 days out of 7. You don't only have 7 days in the week. And so for 6 of those days, I was receiving some type of biblical story. And the one that I was like, thought was the most fascinating was, you know, a wife cheating on her husband at the very, that's how it popped off.
Yeah.
And so because I thought it was such an interesting story, somehow because of all of those Bible class, you know, stories reverberating for me, then it became natural that some of the way that I see relationships is still within the context of that allegory. So you mm-hmm. always see that allegory, not necessarily from a female's perspective. Sometimes it's the man, sometimes it's the woman, but love and the struggle to remain in love and honor that love, I've always thought was very interesting. And so that's why it always seems to be an allegory that turns up in all of my work.
I love it. Well, congratulations on everything. I have two super random questions. Do you still have your Pumas?
Hell no. Do you know how those Pumas would stink up my house and yours if them Pumas were still around? Shit, no.
I'm dead. What did they look like?
They were fly. They were red. They were low soles. You remember the back in the day, those specific type of Pumas when we still had wide leg jeans? Those were the Pumas that I was walking. I had walked the back of my jeans off on the soles of those red Pumas.
I'm dead. Okay.
Are you hating?
You said what?
You hating on my Pumas?
No, I love them. Not at all. No, I love. Listen, I'm that girl that still runs Fila's. Okay. I live. No, I love a good pair of shoes and Pumas. I love one because they're comfortable. Those insoles, but I'm probably like an Adidas. I try not to support Nike too much, but I know, right? Levels. But no, second question. Did you ever decide on getting your neck tattoo?
I'm still undecided. So I'm gonna get a fake neck tattoo this coming up week.
Okay.
Just to see if I have more problems or less problems. Because it could go either way. You know what I mean? You know what I mean?
Exactly. It's that. What would you get if you could get a neck tattoo? What would you get of?
I'm gonna get a cross, just cheesy, because I'm a cheesy dude. So I was gonna get like this cross, like right here, instead of the earring, because I have really tiny ears. That's why you can see the whole ear earbud. So I have really tiny ears. So I would get like instead of the cool cross on my earring, I would just get like one right there on my neck. My mom would pass out. Pass out.
See, Do you have any tattoos at all?
Yeah, I have 7.
Oh, okay. Well.
I'm tatted up.
See, I have none. And I think I don't know if it's because Christian choices, I just don't. But again, congratulations. Oh, and then last question for people, independent filmmakers who are in here, what is the best advice that you would give just in general? I know that that's a super broad question, but what is just the best advice that you would give to independent filmmakers trying to make something right now?
You know what? That is a really tough thing because I actually do lectures about this all the time. I always am able to go out and talk to filmmakers. What I would say is trust your intuition. If someone tells you they're trash, they're trash. If a production company seems like they're going to not appreciate you, they're not going to appreciate you. I mean, just in our personal lives, we have to remember all the times that our heart told us something, but we didn't quite go with it, but it became true anyhow. And so I would say trust your intuition. I mean, I'm kind of going through that right now with some of the deals that I have on the table. And I'm like, heart, tell me what to do, because my mind said, go get this money. Mm-hmm. That's what my mind says. But my heart says I would be better suited with another opportunity that I get to be in charge of and still have ownership in. And so those are the different two tracks. So I would tell filmmakers to 100% follow their heart and trust their intuition, because there's a reason why you have it.
Mm. Okay. You know? Come on. Well, thank you so much, Dewey.
My pleasure.
Congratulations on everything. I look forward to everything else that you have in store and that season 2, because all right, I'm going to put it into fruition because I need it. Everybody watching this live needs it. The world needs it. I love it. So congratulations and have the best week that you can.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. You have a great week, too.
You too. Bye-bye.
Where is the buzz? You said it was mine.
Where is the buzz?